The U.S. National Science Foundation is critical to the critical mineral industry. The geologic processes, where are critical minerals located? How can we refine those critical minerals so that they occur in concentrations that are useful? Designing electronics that maybe use different rare earth elements or different critical minerals. The production of materials and those kinds of important areas to our national well-being.
This is the Discovery Files podcast from the U.S. National Science Foundation. I'm Nate Podker. Critical minerals, including rare earth elements, are essential raw materials and production inputs required for economic and national security. Rare earth elements are critical components in almost all modern technologies, from smartphones to batteries, hard drives, and satellites. However, these elements are notoriously hard to extract from the Earth's crust and even to separate from one another. To learn more about critical minerals and rare earth elements, we are joined by Rachel Teasdale, a professor at California State University, Chico, and a program director in the Division of Earth Sciences at the U.S. National Science Foundation. Dr. Teasdale, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.
So my first question, critical minerals, rare earth elements, we hear all these different terms. Are they the same thing?
Not specifically, not technically. So an element and a mineral are two different things in science, but those terms have come to have common usage interchangeably.
Like, how does a mineral or an element get designated as being critical?
So the United States Geological Survey is tasked with deciding what elements are considered to be critical. And that designation is based on basically supply and demand. So what is the demand? What elements are critical to the national economy and the national defense? And in terms of supply, they look at whether those elements have a risk of their supply chain being disrupted. And also in terms of supply, are there substitutes for those elements? Our modern society now really does depend on rare earths.
What are some more common items that people may use every day that use rare earths?
Sure. I mean, we're all using rare earths right now to record this, to watch this video. People are using rare earths in terms of their, maybe they're watching it on a cell phone or on a computer. So the battery in the cell phone or the computer uses neodymium. The screen that you're watching any video on includes or contains lanthanum. The electronics, again, neodymium, some cobalt. In our cars, there are lots of rare earths and critical minerals. Petroleum products are processed using rare earths and critical minerals. Power steering uses them as well. So pretty much every aspect of our modern lives is reliant on them.
What role does science play in the critical mineral industry?
Well, science truly is in and of itself critical for the advancement of our ability to find critical minerals, process them efficiently, process them in ways that are in alignment with the communities where these mines might occur. As scientists, we look for ways to make the recycling more efficient so that we can reuse the critical minerals that already exist, and that reduces our reliance on international trade and supply chains. All areas of science are involved in the critical mineral industry. Chemistry, engineering, materials science, geoscientists, educators, all areas of science and the National Science Foundation are involved in the critical mineral industry.
So thinking about, like, you went a little bit into the structure, like how these things are formed. Are there only certain specific parts of the world where you can find rare earths and critical minerals?
Rare earth elements or critical minerals often are associated with volcanoes. They also do occur in places where there are, we call them evaporite environments, so a shallow sea or lake. So as water evaporates from a shallow water environment, then minerals will crystallize out of those environments, and sometimes rare earths are associated with them. Another place where we find rare earths is where volcanoes have eroded. So we might find them in stream beds or at least in minerals that are found in stream beds. And scientists are looking for those. We support scientists who look for these deposits of rare earths with the idea of looking for places that might be mineable, but also places where the rare earths might have accumulated from other processes.
So can the United States, or do we produce our own critical minerals and rare earths?
We have one mine where we do extract rare earth elements. And there are a couple others that are under investigation. So scientists are looking to see if the rare earths occur in a large enough abundance that they might be efficient enough to be mined. But we don't produce very much in terms of processing and refining. I mentioned that these rare earths occur in low abundances. So that means it's a more challenging and expensive process to extract the actual elements from the rock body that they're found in. And most of that is occurring in China, and so we're importing a lot of what we use. But there are scientists who are partnering with industry to try and develop and get into production these processing facilities here in the U.S. so that we can reduce the risk of supply chain issues.
Can you talk a little bit about how might you refine rare earth elements to get to the bits that you need from other forms?
Right. So at a bulk level, you can imagine a rock that has a whole bunch of minerals and very few of them contain rare earths. And so first we have to crush that rock and get it into smaller pieces. And then they go through a series of chemical processes. And so chemists are working on developing processes that make that more efficient. When the rocks are being broken down, there's a lot of waste. And that waste can get stored at the mine in these big tailings piles. And one of the really cool things that our scientists are finding out now is that we can look in those giant tailings piles and find materials that now have critical importance. They may not have had that importance at the time that they were mined, but now they do. And with science and research, our geoscientists and chemists and engineers are developing ways that we can more efficiently extract those rare earths from what was once considered to be waste.
I'm aware of one case where with the aluminum process, they have this red mud that's exactly what you're talking about, where it's the byproduct of the process that can in fact produce other things of use.
Yeah, that's exactly it. The aluminum processing creates these ponds where the aluminum is in high proportion. It happens at other mines as well, and other materials, other critical minerals or rare earth elements accumulate in similar ways. And like I said before, it was considered to be waste material and would just be stored for the ages, but now we're developing ways that we can extract that so that we're basically mining the waste.
So thinking about this from a little bit of a different perspective, for these rare earths that have been used in, say, computer chips or something, can we recover those elements and recycle it to be used again? Or is the lifespan kind of not useful in that way?
We absolutely can recover rare earths from existing materials. So a lot of times when somebody gets a new cell phone, they throw the old one in a drawer. And it's sort of a hidden stockpile, right? Because that cell phone has all the rare earth elements that we were talking about before. And so we basically have these sort of mini mines in all of our kitchen drawers. If those cell phones were recycled, then we could extract the elements that we need for our national defense and for our national economy. So we want to make sure that old cell phones and electronics and all the other materials where we're using rare earths, we want to make sure that those are being recycled as well. And another really exciting area of science is where engineers and material scientists are trying to figure out ways to build those products where recyclability is more likely. So if it's really hard to get something like neodymium out of a material that was used to create it, then it's going to be harder to recycle. But new science is being worked on where they can make the neodymium a little more extractable out of that battery that it's using or is being used to create the battery in the first place.
So what are some of the ways you see NSF supporting these national priorities around critical minerals?
NSF supports the science behind critical minerals and rare earth elements every day. We have scientists who are looking for new sources of critical minerals and rare earth elements. We have scientists who are looking for ways we can extract those elements in more efficient ways, in ways that have less impact on the environment or on the communities where these mines exist. We have scientists who are working on more efficient ways of processing the elements so that we can get more of them from every bit of rock that is produced. We have scientists who are working on ways to recycle products that are already using the critical metals or the rare earth elements, and ways that we can build products in the first place where they are more recyclable. The other way that NSF is supporting critical minerals and rare earth element sort of technology is by helping to create the workforce that's needed to train more scientists to work in all these aspects of the critical mineral industry.
So thinking about that workforce, where do you see that field developing in the next few years?
Well, right now there's a shortage of workforce. So jobs are very much available for folks who have an interest or some training in areas of critical minerals or the critical mineral industry. I mentioned geoscientists who are looking for these geologic deposits that contain the critical minerals. Hydrogeologists look for water or clean sources of water or ways to remediate water that's been contaminated. And water is a huge part of the critical mineral processing. Chemists and material scientists and engineers are all involved as well. And then, of course, in the workforce development itself, we need educators and we need partnerships between industry and scientists. So all of those areas are really a growing industry and a really valuable industry to the U.S. success economically as well as in national defense.
What are some of the ways you see NSF supporting the critical minerals industry?
Well, the U.S. National Science Foundation plays a very strong role in the critical mineral industry. In fact, the U.S. National Science Foundation is critical to the critical mineral industry. We have scientists we are supporting who are involved in the geologic processes. Where are critical minerals located? How can we refine those critical minerals so that they occur in concentrations that are useful? We have chemists who are working in similar processes. We have material scientists who we support in all aspects of critical minerals, particularly in the production of materials in ways that they might be more recyclable at the end of their life. We have engineers that we support who are also working on critical minerals in terms of designing electronics that maybe use different rare earth elements or different critical minerals and looking for substitutes so that we have a diversity of minerals and elements that we can use for electronics, national defense, and those kinds of important areas to our national well-being.
I think for my last question, I want to ask you about what we'll see in the next few years. You mentioned scientists are out there looking for other caches of these rare earth elements. Based on your understanding of volcanology, would you expect there to be a lot more that we haven't found yet?
I think there's definitely a lot more sources out there. There are lots of geologic regions that haven't been explored or are currently being explored by scientists who are supported by NSF. I think the development of materials in ways that make them more recyclable will be an important part of our future, as well as making more efficient the recycling process itself. Chemists and materials scientists are working on ways to process the critical minerals as well as in the construction of products that use them. So I think those are all the way forward. And again, a really exciting part of the geoscientist's role is in finding ways to process waste material. We already have it at the surface. We don't need to dig another big hole to access it. And what was once considered waste can be critical to our economy and our national defense.
Special thanks to Rachel Teasdale. For the Discovery Files, I'm Nate Podker. Please subscribe wherever you get podcasts, and if you like our program, share with a friend and consider leaving a review. Discover how the U.S. National Science Foundation is advancing research at nsf.gov.